I would like to introduce now our speaker at our mathematics and applied mathematics environment seminar. It is also joined with our little MEM seminar for PhD students, Herman Garcia. We are now all on Zoom, but it's our environment is at Mälardalen University in Västerås, Sweden, and Herman Garcia, he is a PhD student at our university, at our environment in mathematics, with me as a main supervisor, and he, as part of his research education, will give now a series of lectures about non-commutative determinants and quasi-determinants. And this is first lecture in this series, and I think that could be an interesting journey for everybody. And it's, I hope you can join both this lecture and coming lectures, which we will be announcing separately. So Herman, it's your turn to speak.
All right. Thank you very much again for the introduction. Welcome everybody, this is Herman Garcia, and today we're discussing quasi-determinants. As was said before, this is the first of a series of lectures in which we will cover quasi-determinants, non-commutative determinants, and then we will see some applications of that. But for today's lecture, I want to start from absolute scratch. Quasi-determinants are based upon matrices on free division rings, which I will introduce. Then I will talk about definition and inductive definition and different processes about building the quasi-determinants. Much more can be said about quasi-determinants when they are worked over a ring with unit. So I will spend some time on there. Quasi-determinant is built to mimic somehow some properties, fundamental properties of a determinant as a generalizational tool. So we will stop on that. Then I will show you how some basics of commutative linear algebra, such as the Cramer rule for solving linear systems, works as well in the non-commutative setting using the help of quasi-determinants. And in the end, if we have time, I will give you a very interesting example in quaternions. We will see an extension of quaternions to quaternions with complex coefficients, an embedding there of some sorts, and we will see. Quaternionic norm based on the notion of quasi-determinants. So to begin with, I'm going to let X be a finite set with cardinality M and F of X, calligraphic F of X to distinguish from different one is the free algebra generated by these elements here with four operations, two binary operations, plus and times your typical sum and product, and then two unary operations, inversion and minus. No additional restrictions on these applications. So things like this exist without any sort of problem. Now, an element here is called a rational expression. Alternatively, a formula. Moving on, I'm going to let P of X be the set of formulas without division. Thank you. So first thing that we notice is this trivial inclusion here. But it will be useful later. So I think it's good to mention it. Now, the algebra is defined over. Imagine that we have an algebra over Q, R. Alternatively, this algebra can be built over any field of characteristic zero, for example, an old friend of ours. And G, a set that's contained here. And beta, a map that goes in that. If such duo will receive different names depending on their properties in respects, I proceed to enumerate them. So in respects minus, provided that A and B are elements of G, then beta respect sum and product third property. If this thing is invertible on R, then we respect inversion as well. With these three properties, we will say that G beta is a partial homomorphism. Of this thing right here. Now, we consider these indices and we have this property. In beta sends the elements that generate f of x to the same place as alpha. If it holds as well, we will say that g beta. Is an extension of alpha. Finally, there is an additional property, but in order to introduce that, I have to talk about the intersection of extensions. If we have two extensions of a map, extensions of alpha, of beta for consistency. Then this thing is another extension of map alpha, sort of intersection condition by the image of beta 1 and beta 2, since they're both extensions that things should happen. We can use this in group to define other extensions as the intersection of a finite amount of them. The intersection of all extensions is another extension. We will note it this way. And it's called the canonical extension. Now, here the word canonical may raise some eyebrows, but the thing is, it exists. Now, I'll proceed to show that now. We see that if we pick such a G that we have a partial homomorphism, it can be shown that G contains P of X, the set of formulas without division. And so alpha restricted to P of X that we will name alpha. This thing is an extension. So there is always at least one extension for this map, which makes it so talking about the canonical extension makes sense. Now, the reason why talking about the canonical extension is the following. One thing that will be very, very important for us to work with quasi-determinants is the ability to evaluate maps. You say that alpha can be evaluated this if this element is the canonical extension. Is in the canonical extension. Now, I think it's 1, 2, 2 for those of you who are reading the document. No, it's 1, 1, 2. Now, we let this thing happen. Sorry, it's not a Q, it has sent a Q. The equivalence classes over, of elements like this form another division ring. Which is called FD of X. Now the really interesting part of this is property 2 of the theorem, the really interesting part here is that if D1 and D2 are infinite dimensional, and have center Q, then we observe the following phenomenon. The projections of these two things over f of x induce this isomorphism. So it makes sense that we take the structure of that up to isomorphism call it f of x and let it be the free division ring. Now we have indeed a free division, which is exactly that one. Naturally, in this division ring, evaluating these sort of maps has a slight catch. That catch is that instead of having here just an element, we will have the representative of an equivalence class. And so alpha can be evaluated at f in f of x. Definition, if there is an element which is in the canonical extension that is in the equivalence class of F. In that case, we associate the image of the class with the image of that element that is within the equivalence class. Okay, so I'm going to write a couple of notes here and we can begin talking about quasi-determinants. Algebra. This is our free division ring. And this is our canonical extension of map alpha. Now, I accidentally deleted half of my schedule. So let's begin with section two. Slight detail here, alpha is such a map. And it's important to keep in mind. So in order to talk about quasi-determinants, let I and j be two sets of indices such like that they have the same cardinality, and x be the following generating set. This being formal variables over f of x. Now, first thing we notice is we can build this matrix with formal entries ij, where in the position ij we have the element ij. A sec. There. So the first and one of the most important propositions slash property, that's why I use prop as an abbreviation, is that X is invertible. For a quick sketch of the proof, which will be interesting to sketch, but not really to get into much detail of, we can divide this matrix into blocks, where this is n minus 1 times n minus 1. This is a row vector. This is a column vector. And this is another element. And the inverse matrix, if it exists, will be given in blocks as well. With the funny catch that we can calculate these things directly. If we check this for an instance, everything seems to work fine. Unless core, and there are similar expressions for the other four blocks. But the idea of this proof is that we find a matrix that when we multiply both, we get the identity matrix, and so we have inverted. And what is really interesting here, and I want you to note there, is that the way we're going to define the quasi-determinants is based basically like that. Sorry. We define the ijth quasi-determinant as the inverse of the transposed element of the inverse matrix. This way, I am to give you a little example here. We have a simple 2x2 matrix. The first quasi-determinant is no other than that. Of course, the quasi-determinant is not unique. We have one for its component. Now the really interesting thing about this proof is that we can keep rolling this and obtain a recurrence relationship for quasi determinants. we have this sort of recurrent formula in which the sum is on the elements I prime and J prime in such a way that I prime is different than I, J prime is different than J, and this thing that we are going to be finding constantly along this talk and probably the next one is the matrix X is, it's an N minus one times N minus one matrix that comes from deleting row I and column J. So very important here is X super IJ, which reasonably looks like X in power minus IJ, but it's definitely not the case. There we go. So now let's go back to our small 2x2 matrix. I'm going to use this to calculate x to 1. This quasi determinant is no other than x to 1 minus x to 1. Sorry, x to 2, x 1, 2, minus 1, x 1, 1, right? Because here I prime is different than 2, so it's 1, and j prime is different than 1, so it's 2. Is this correct? Looks like it. Okay, this is one of the four quasi-determinants of this small 2x2 matrix. If you want to go for a 3x3 matrix, we have 9 quasi-determinants, and I'm giving you the formula for one. Let's see if I can copy this correctly. It's a continuation of the minus sign. X 1 3 So this is quasi determinant 1-1 of this 3x3 matrix.
It's correct. It's correct. It seems to be correct. Now, it's not here, so we never forget it. Moving on. Okay. Give me a second, please. Now, the next thing we may have to worry about is relative matrices. It's what happens when you swap rows and columns. And we have this theorem that tells us that if we have an action whose effect is basically to swap rows or columns, or actually it swaps the indices, so the effect on the matrix is swapping rows and columns, then it acts on the determinant in this way. Which is interesting. Now, the main idea behind this result is that we do not need to have a bijection between I and J for us to be able to manipulate these matrices correctly. So now, oh, that sounded terribly. So I'm moving on into the range within it. And I'm just to start defining a map. That depends on this matrix that sends the formal variable xij to the element ij of the matrix. Now, the main idea behind this is that if alpha sub A can be evaluated at this quasi-determinant, then this thing is no other than that. And that, if all inversions are possible, gives us a proper way to compute quasi-determinants. We search for this map. We substitute everything. We can actually play with elements in this on this thing. Also, accidentally, since that quasi-determinant that is defined this way is in the Q-algebra, which is may sound trivial, but it's your typical detail that may not be true, and you're playing with it like it was. Well, here it happens to be working properly. Okay. Now, by using this definition, we have a way to compute this quasi-determinant pretty fast. But first, I'm going to give you a little note here. And we mark this row and this column, okay? If we forget element A, I, J, then this remaining row vector is what we call R, I, J. Row I without element J. And this column, again, we delete that. We're going to call it C, J, I. Column J without element I. And this allows us to redefine the formula for the quasi-determinant. I don't know what you think, but I think this could be more manageable in some sense. Now we have a little problem here. Our problem is actually here. And is that when we work with these rational expressions, if for example we have zeros on the matrix, some of these inversions may not be possible. So we have to rewrite these expressions to take out those impossibilities. A very interesting case of that will be this matrix. Here, the quasi-determinant 3-1 is not possible, or at least shouldn't be possible to compute because this zero is not invertible. However, you could one could rewrite the rational formula, or consider that thing is invertible, and we can go straight to the definitions straight to this definition and use it to compute the quasi-determinant. It's an additional difficulty. We always have to take care of non-invertible elements. Now, but one may be wondering, how many quasi-determinants does a square matrix have? In this case, this one has 9, and actually all generic matrices have n squared quasi determinant. With generic here, what I mean is that all its square minors are invertible. For non-generic matrices, there might be a number between 0 and n squared, which is the number of quasi-determinants. All right. Where is the other eraser? There. Now, a very interesting example and something that can be seen from that proposition is the following. Give me a sec. Want to write it correctly? In the commutative setting, this becomes this thing right here, which is a actually very, very beautiful way to compute the quasi-determinants. I wanted to show this because it showcases that the quasi-determinant is not strictly a generalization of the determinant, but it's more of a generalized quotient of determinants, one could say. They're slightly off site. Should be better.
Yeah, pretty much. Now, by all means, it looks like quasi-determinants are rational functions. As in elements of f(x). However, the next thing that we may be wondering is when can those rational functions become polynomials over the variables? And in our case, we have a quasi-triangular matrix. We have a quasi-triangular matrix.
I think it was with ones. No, it's with minus ones.
You know how this goes.
You write it down correctly. This thing, this determinant, is no other than. There are many indices here. This product over here. Of course, I forgot to mention, but here I've jumped to a commutative setting. So the interesting thing that I wanted to share is that this is a polynomial in the variables here, provided that they commute. If we call this P of it, I have forgotten something.
there is a notation for quasi-determinants that I absolutely forgot about, and it's in order to refer to the ij quasi-determinant, we can go to the determinant drawing kinda, and then frame the corresponding element. So now we're looking for the one nth quasi-determinant. If we were to go on a commutative setting, if this were commutative, then the determinant would be no other than this right here, which comes pretty handy. And with this, I think I close rings with unit, and I'm going to start showcasing determinant-like properties of this incredible tool that quasi-determinants are. Can get rid of this, I think. Now I'm going to cover some transformational properties, especially one with that relates regular and Hadamard inverses that I found absolutely amazing. So again, to remember this thing, we have our matrix. We already know from the action of the symmetric group, we know that if we do permutations of columns and rows that don't involve the row and column, our quasi-determinant is, what if the quasi-determinant doesn't change? If we multiply the ith row by lambda, we have this matrix, and we multiply a row by lambda on the left. Lambda is an element of the ring. Then what happens with the determinant is what was expected. We multiply the row by lambda on the left. The corresponding quasi-determinants are multiplied by lambda on the left as well. Now let's see what happens with the columns. What happens with the, if we multiply a column is exactly what was to be expected. IL here and IL otherwise. So multiplication by rows, multiplication by columns, there are two things that get quasi-determinants pretty close to determinants. That's a very, very convenient position. for the third property. If we, what happens if we add a column? Sorry, we add rows or we add columns? So we have rows L and K, and we respect the rest. What happens here? Is absolutely nothing, which is kind of what we were expecting. Finally, columns. This way. What happens with the quasi-determinants is once again absolutely nothing. So this comes to showcase that the quasi-determinant actually has very interesting properties. Now, I think you're going to like this one. So we have a matrix. Assume it's invertible. And and the Hadamard inverse. Now from here, two obvious things. And one that may not be so obvious. From here, since this is the inverse by definition of the quasi-determinant, this definition of the quasi-determinant, and I can rewrite this in a very interesting form. Of course, if all these exist. All right. The next thing we wonder when working with quasi-determinants is how does it react to the tensor problem? Let's this thing be the ij quasi-determinant of A, this thing be the quasi-determinant alpha, the alpha beta f quasi-determinant of B, and what happens? Let me write this down correctly. Is nothing else okay. So the quasi-determinant seems to be pretty well behaved when it comes to tensor product as well.
The good news start piling up and they just don't stop.
Now, I'm going to give you one of the what I think is pretty important property of determinants. The following three propositions are equivalent. This is the first.
I finished the pen.
That's the second, and the third one, you're probably already seeing it coming. So we have the same result that we have in the, by using the commutative determinants. Means that if either row or the jth column is in a combination, the quasi-determinant is zero, but it's also reversed. So we can actually talk about rank here. Actually, I will not get into much detail, but this thing will allow us to talk about row rank and column rank and how those things are actually the same, one and the same. Anyway. I'm going to give you some more interesting results if you're not familiar with linear algebra. In the following form, this is a theorem that I had never seen, like not even once, and then I found the generalized version at once. So how a generalization for Silvestrov's identity as well. We have a matrix over there in R
A zero is a square submatrix of order k. That is invertible. Now, we pick up two new indices and define these elements. Define CPQ as this quasi-determinant here. Obviously, this big boy here is a matrix for n minus k, square matrix, of course. A0 is what we're going to call pivot. And Silvestrov's identity is telling us that those quasi-determinants are one and the same. In the commutative version, what we have instead is that formula over there that may sound familiar to everyone in this room but me. Now I want to remark something here, and is that from here we see that the quasi-determinant of a matrix of size n is exactly the same as the quasi-determinant of a smaller matrix made of bigger blocks, which are named, by the way, as quasi-minors. So, okay, it's 4:45. So I think I'm going to give you two more fundamental results of non-linear algebra, and then we call this a day. So let's finish in a glamorous fashion. So, you know, at the rate that we are seeing classical theorems of determinants extended to quasi-determinants, you may probably be able to know where I'm going already. And the last thing I'm telling you is how to use this thing. So let's suppose that we are working on a non-commutative ring. Our hypothesis is that this thing exists and are invertible. And the first one we have is theorem 161, which is your regular everyday castle of linear equations.
So this has a solution. If and only if. This thing exists. So the way we are going to solve linear systems in a non-commutative setting is the exact same. We only have to take care that these quasi-determinants both exist and are invertible, because otherwise we have problems. But for certain cases, we have another tool that may help us even further, which is Cramer's proof. So we call AL of this letter, who I never knew the name of. I'm going to place a column with index L with our vector of independent terms. And so by using the notation here, another interesting one. Finally, I'm giving you another one more. The first time I saw the proof for the commutative version of this theorem, it literally gave me nightmares for a couple of days. So I will not go through the proof of this one. But it basically says that if we set where this thing is the identity matrix, first of all, this is a rational function. On the variable t, I'm struggling to write this on a whiteboard, honestly. So let's do it backwards. We have fij of t, and do the following replacements. Aij becomes the matrix in n dimensions. Variable t becomes matrix A. And I really thought this would be a little hard to. Okay. We have these two replacements, and we call the result Fij of t with a hat. This are known as characteristic functions. And of course, Cayley-Hamilton theorem says that right there. And with this, I think we have three very important tools for understanding non-commutative linear algebra, and is that solving linear systems is can be done in a similar fashion as in the commutative setting. We can use the Cramer's rule by taking care of the determinants, and Cayley-Hamilton theorem assures that the characteristic functions have zeros where they should. So I think I'm going to call this a day. It's almost five. I was expecting this lecture to be a little shorter. And now if you have questions, I will be glad to answer them.